What's up, guys? Pittsburgh White Schwartz back again with another deck tech for you. This one's a little different. It's going to be a first look, kind of a theory craft for Seven Deadly Sins, which is releasing today, which is pretty exciting. Woo! Joined today by Andy.
What's up, guys? Here mostly for moral support, but yeah, let's talk about some Seven Deadly Sins.
Yep. So just wanted to go over one or two. They're pretty similar builds, but just sort of the smoke test, sort of where we're going to start testing. Then I thought it would be cool to sort of like come back to this video after people got their hands on the set and it'd be out for a couple weeks, and we can do like a revisit and see how the list has changed, if it's even anything close, or if anybody's discovered anything. But after looking over the set, it's been on Encore for like a week or like half a week now. This is sort of where I started. I have Door Choice and 8 Choice to look at. They end up looking pretty similar, but this is sort of my starting point. And we're going to jump right into the cards real quick here. So we're going to start out with sort of our field pluses. We have the Gil Thunder, which is a chaser. On play, you reveal top, and as long as that card is a character, all characters in the set are Britannia, which is cool. There's no trait stuff. You put it underneath, and then he is 3500 cross turn, and then he is a chaser. So you chase in front of cards, which makes it so and mitigate your damage, make slow down the level zero, giving you more turns to sort of sculpt for your level one. It's always good. And then we have this really good clean cut, which is, if you're familiar with the JP meta, it's a Nemu clean cut from DeCapo. So it's on play. As long as you have another character, he gets a level and 1500 power. You don't have to reveal top or anything like Rem, he just gets it. And then clean cut, one of the best clean cut profiles ever printed, probably the best one. Make sure that when we have the opportunity to generate a lot of stock by attacking three times, or we want to go more aggressive because our hand's already set, we can try field, move our brainstorm or tech card to the back row, giving us just sort of that really good plus, being able to attack with our card that would normally just chill back there. Pretty solid level zero lineup, sort of reminiscent of Thal 10th a little bit. You got like the chaser, which like kind of like the center runner, and then you also have this really good clean cut. So really cool field plusing lineup to like have both the ability to go slow if you want or speed up, at least in theory. There's also, go ahead.
I was gonna say, is this are these your builds, or are these kind of just like what you looked at and saw that most people were playing?
These are builds that came up with after just looking at the set and talking with a couple other people on Discord and whatnot about what would be played, should be played, blah blah blah, kicking over some cards. So just some starting point.
I gotcha. I know people were really hyping up the level zero lineup of Seven Deadly Sins was what was really talked about the set, like that and the Meliodas finisher, but we'll get to that later. But the level zero lineup is like pretty fire with these two cards.
Yeah, this can make your level zero lineup in terms of just playing the level zero game, like winning board, like knifing clean cuts, like sort of dictating the flow of how the level zero game will go, because you can either, like I said, go fast or mitigate damage by running your Gil Thunder in front of stuff. You also have a card that gives global 5, so these cards can be 4k, which will scale over literally anything, or tie, which is pretty cool. Moving on.
Yeah, that's, it's pretty disgusting.
Yeah, moving on to our other cards here. We got 3 of the Hawk Krista, so that's a Salvage Ricky for level 1 and lower, but then on play, he force mill 2 if you had a Climax, give anything 15. It's fine. It's not the best Ricky, but being locked at level 0 for any of decks, pretty bad, even with how our high quality our cards are. If our opponent's at level 1 first, 4k stops being enough a lot of the time. So we don't want to be locked if we don't have to be, so we're running this just to make sure we can get to level 1. And the fact that he puts 2 cards in graves first, because you can order these however you want, does sort of make him a little better. He can mill his own better targets into grave. And then we got the Elaine, which is Raldeck Toka, familiar with Datalive. So on play, reveal top, if it's a character, add ditch, and then discard a character draw, order those effects in whatever way you want. If you're digging for climaxes, you reveal top card first and then ditch draw, but if you're digging for like a trigger, you usually do it the other way around. So really versatile filter card for just sort of making sure we can get into climax. So these are like sort of our level 1 assurance cards, is the idea. This is our Hawk for making sure that we keep our hand size big and can find our pieces for level 1, and Elaine is helping us rip into our climax.
Mm-hmm. little side note, I'm really happy they decided to print the Elaine as just a normal rare instead of a Trialbeck exclusive card or like a $50 box topper or something.
Yeah, just including it in the set.
Because like nice. Goblin Slayer and Datalive both had this exact same card profile, but they were absurdly expensive because they were kind of like hard to get because they were in special products. But this should be very easy to get, and it's a very strong card profile.
Moving on to our back row, pretty simple here. Unfortunately, the set is pretty scuffed for Brainstorms. Your only option is basically this Merlin here. It gives 500 to center, and then it's a rest self-salvage. It does salvage anything. There's no weird trait fuckery in this set, like some other English exclusives, but does salvage anything. You don't gotta worry about anything like that. But again, this is like your only brainstorm option. It's like this or a draw brainstorm. Pretty depressing. So you'll see this card in pretty much every single 7 Deadly Sin set. But you could do a lot worse than this card. 500 to center is totally okay as a second effect, and salvage brainstorms are preferable when you're filling your grave, which we are on our first deck for sure. So going into the end game, you know, there's Climax left in a small deck or something like that, or end of our first deck rather, we can grab sort of from our whole pool. Other card here is a little bit, yeah, go ahead.
I was gonna say, you know, get the Climaxes out of your deck and then get some nice plussing before you go for your refresh. And even though you don't have a lot of variety for brainstorms, you know, this one's a really solid one. So
You could do a lot worse than this.
I'm really not too upset looking at that.
The other card's a little bit more interesting. If you're familiar again with Dakafo and the Japanese meta, this is the Hazuki back row, this King Breakdown. It's a global 5, which is really good with our level 0 and level 1 lineup. We'll get into why when we get to our level 1s. We already talked about it when it comes to our level 0s, or puts our level 0s to 4k, and they're either dodging combat, running in front of things, or clean cutting stuff, so we want to scale over stuff. This is obviously also a good clean cut target, so having like sort of these 5 good targets for our clean cut makes that even better. But anyway, his other effect is the reason why he's so good. You tap it, you choose one of your characters, and you give it on reverse, kick your opponent's character to clock. That card, their top card of clock goes to waiting room, and then the card that you reverse goes to their clock. So what this does is it hard removes standby targets if you can scale over them, so like 1/1s or 2/2s with hand encore all throughout the game, so it retains its value no matter what. But at level 0, it removes cards from the field, so before they can do their on reverse effect. So if people have stuff like
like when it hits the waiting room, you do an effect, this sends it to clock instead, so they don't get that effect.
It even denies effects that they get on reverse as well, since your effect will proc first and they'll no longer be on the field. If it's a card that has to go to memory, like the Wildberry Princess, that effect will never be able to proc, because part of that card's cost is send itself to memory
from the field.
Yeah, so this card, again, we're mostly running it for the global 5, just sort of makes our level 0 and level 1 pretty obnoxious. But on top of that, it's a great utility ability staple to it, depending on the matchup. Because again, even when you're getting to your like Diane Water Goddesses that are swinging in pretty big, you grow over that stuff. At the end game, your opponent can't hard encore things. Very useful effect.
Yeah, not gonna lie, this seems like one of the standout cards in the set. This common seems like very, very, very good. Just throughout the entire game, it's going to be useful. At level 0 to deny their filtering effects, or later in the game to not let them encore their big characters they put a lot of resources to get onto the field.
Yeah, unless someone is going like very aggressive and very lean and like doesn't care about protecting their cards at all throughout the game, I do think you'll see this most of the time, or at least as a one of. I think it's a very powerful
effect. I think one or two. I like that you have it at a two of. I think that's a really good number, because it's something you want to see throughout the game, right? You want to see it early or later in the game, but you only really need one copy.
Yeah, alternate copies are just completely dead, though. All right, moving on to our last level zeros. This Elizabeth here, if you're familiar with Bang Dream, this is the Baguette Drop Search, good old Kokoro Drop Search. When it's in center, it's a costless 2 soul beater, and then Drop Search, really good effect. And then
I can't believe they got that card. That's so sick. I love that profile.
They also got the Kaguya Climax Swapper, same as Jizuru as well, from Rasaya. Top check 2 rearrange and pay 1 to Climax. That was a Climax. Really good consistency effect. Top check 2 rearrange, always good. Informs your triggers, things like that. Lets you sort of go into your final turns with like trigger knowledge, so that if you're trying to set up sides or something like that, you can. Which might be relevant considering that your Meliodas, you know, he has to stick around even though he's hexproof and he's really big. Sometimes your opponent might have some sort of trick going on, like a tap counter or something, where you generate that stock. If you go for a side, this can help you set up one, sort of like side for one, side for two, or something like that. It's always nice.
By the way, also has incredible synergy with the Arisu profile from before, the Elaine from a couple slides back. Being able to look at the top two cards of your deck and then know exactly whether you want to do the draw discard effect first or the discard draw effect first, because each of those have their own specific uses because they only hit on characters or whatever. So being able to get the perfect Arisu effect every time, being able to take the guesswork out of it is actually really, really handy.
But yeah, pretty clean level 0 lineup. Lots of, you know, lots of 3s, lots of 3/4s, but that's just sort of how I tend to build decks, especially when our level one combos in particular selective, which we will talk about right now. So this is Elaine. She is you have two or more other characters plus 1,000 powers. She's 5,500 cross turn. And then on attack with the door, Fountain of Youth, you check up to top four, add any character from among them. So familiar with Amelia or Crystal Song Yukina, it's the Magura effect. So pretty vanilla level one advantage combo. It's on attack. We don't have to worry about getting a reverse. But the important part of this card is that it sits at 5,500 cross turn. 5,500 cross turn with a global five of the relevant effect in the back row will put you ticks, backing up to 8K. That's backing up over standby targets without buffs. Forces your opponent to, at the very least, extend to clear the cards that you were going to play anyway. And we have some like good options for being able to defend these cards. Again, the King back row is a great way to put this card to 6K. Being able to back up to 8K, especially when you have Leafas at level one in this set, are just extending your ability to have this card be able to combo off again with your Climax swappers and like that. So any Climax you draw, you just swap back into it and combo off again. The card's on attack. You're not punished for winning all your lanes. You have these out because you don't need to find a reverse to get your combo off again. So you're free to win board. And it also makes it so you don't really care if you get to one first or second. You would prefer to get there first, sort of wall off again. But because you're on attack, it's not that big of a deal. End up getting shot up either, or shot up second rather. But just a pretty solid, effective level one combo. Also patches problems with first deck deck speed that this set would otherwise have. There is a bond like on reverse Rize that you can play that kind of can shore up other builds, but I think going into this is like a big reason you would want to play the Magura over the other combos, is that the extra two cards of mill versus the cigarettes combo are going to get you to a better refresh more often. This card also has another payoff, which we'll talk about when we get to level three.
Yep, you also get the gate trigger instead of having to run maybe eight choice or a more awkward trigger lineup. Gate's kind of just the gold standard, so you get to play with one of the best Climax lineups you could play.
Yep, just consistent selective salvage. In terms of additional level ones, I'll go over these other two cards first. Kind of already talked about the counter already. This is a 1-1 Leafa counter, so you reveal top when you play it, and if it's a character, you add it to your hand, then discard a card, so it digs you one card closer to a Climax. To try to cancel when you're in a compressed deck state, sometimes that extra card is really all you need to tip the scales in your favor to cancel. The Elizabeth is an Adachi, so when it becomes reversed, if your opponent has a higher level card in the current level, you send it to stock and pop their top card from stock. They'll remove it from the field, hard remove, but it also has the pay one stand and swap effect. We're not playing standby, so it's not as effective as it is in Data Live with their Yoshino version of this exact same card, except that one's blue, one's yellow, but it still can be fringe useful. And again, these cards have soul triggers. When we're playing choice in our deck, we would prefer to play counters that have soul triggers and ability cards that have soul triggers so that we can pick them up off choice, or if they're not relevant in that matchup, send them to stock, which is always good to have more options. But the big card I want to talk about here is this bond. So in terms of auxiliary level ones in Seven Deadly Sins, you are really stretched for a good option. There's this card. There's like a 7K attacker from the trial deck in yellow. There's a pretty neat card for the choice decks that we'll talk about when we get to there. And then there's like a blue, like 7K on attack. And then you can like ditch a Climax as an act to gain 1,000 power and on reverse draw one, which is good. That'd probably be one of the best auxiliary level ones, but blue is like really gated and really hard to fit into any deck playing any other good cards because blue is like the enemy color. So what we're left here is probably the second best auxiliary level one. So this Bond has a fake drawback because he's a 5,500, which means if you don't have another Britannia character, he can't stand. By level one, if you don't have another character and this card lives, I don't know what kind of game you're having, but it was probably a lost cause anyway. And then on attack, as long as you have two or more other characters, so as long as you're attacking three times, choose the character facing this card and it gets minus 1K, and then this card gets plus 1K. So this card is a 5,500 that attacks in at 7,500 every turn effectively. And if your opponent has tech cards that have filters that are 1,000 power or less, they could just outright die, which would be pretty cool as well. So he's like a, if you're familiar with Sal 10th, he's kind of fulfills the same slot as the Yui, which was just a 7,500 beater all the time, but then that card was small cross turn. This card is going to sit at the same power line as your combo, the 5,500, 6K with the global five. So just a really good striker card that can either challenge or beat over 1/1 standby targets at one. So pretty cool tech card, or auxiliary level one rather. Moving into our level twos, we have the 2/1 Elizabeth back row, 2k assist to level threes in front, and then you, specifically your 3/2 Meliodas get an additional 1,000 power global no matter where they are, and then hexproof, and during that card's battle, which is whenever it is being attacked, you can't get burned. So the second your opponent declares a frontal attack, I believe we had like a ruling on this at one point, as long as they're declaring a front, it is in battle, right? Or is side also in battle? I can't remember.
I believe it's the same ruling as the card captor reflect.
Yes.
It's and that one, if I'm remembering correctly, was it's only in battle if you're being frontal attacked. Your opponent could still side attack you and burn you, but then their normal attack's not going to be very good because they're siding your level 3 character.
Yeah. So this is the card is what makes the 3/2 Meliodas like really worth playing. And there was a bit of discussion about this in Discord, whether you should play this card at 2 or 3, and we were talking about it. And there are more situations than I previously thought where you might need to double field this card for your Meliodas to make sure he goes off, because he has to live cross turn to make sure that his effect will be worth playing. So because you might want to double field this card and we're playing choice, we're going to opt to run 3 just to be safe, to make sure that we have that option open. If our opponent is playing Adventure Time and they have like the sword event and an additional bounce, like with the bubblegum back row, you might need to double field this card, or you'll just the game because your combo won't do anything. So that's why we're running 3. Other level 2 that we're playing is the free fresh counter. Not too much of an explanation needed here. When you're in a bad deck state, you play this. You're playing 8 plusing triggers that can add this card. So if you trigger too many climaxes and then you're grave, you immediately grab it, pay out all those climaxes, and free fresh your deck. It'll win you games that you otherwise couldn't when you're in those terrifying states, and that's why it's in the deck. Also, as a counter with a soul trigger, pretty important.
Yeah, sometimes you're in a really good deck state near the end of your deck, you're very compressed, and then you just trigger 3 climaxes, and you're like, uh-oh.
Yep,
and that's when you play this card down. Pay out those climaxes you just triggered. Paying out 3 is very nice, because it pays out, like, the entire attack step.
Yeah. Moving on to our level 3s that aren't climax combos, we have the Diane Cheerful. This is exactly the same card as Mesmerizing Water Goddess Aqua. 4 or more early play, and always spam it. During your turn, it'll be 11k. Then you discard any card, and you heal the top card of your clock to stock. So it's a 1-cost healer that swings in at 11k. Extremely efficient early play card that stabilizes you and threatens to win field is literally all it needs to. 1-cost healers are, you have to have it such an extremely good reason to not play them. They have to be like completely unplayable from a colors perspective for what your deck's trying to do to not include them. It's just too good. The other card we have here is the Diane Stock Swap. We are probably never going to play it in most games, but if we do not have it in our deck, our opponent will sit on a mountain of stock and none of our cards will do anything. Especially once our Meliodas hit the board, our opponent has the ability to probably just crash out, ignore them, and force them to overswing, because we have to replay the climax for his effect to be active again. So if they live and they're trying to like just sort of ignore us and shove damage through because they had got a damage lead early, we have to be able to deny them to sit on a mountain of stock. So we have to play this card to make sure that our opponents can't disrespect us. It's not too bad. Level 3 pay 1 stock swaps aren't the worst. They're like just barely usable in terms of when you're able to execute the stock swap to get the most value out of it. But at least this one swings at 12k base when your other character's attack gains 1k. So it has like another use as like a wall breaker with all the power pumps that you have, like a decent third lane. So not the most useless card otherwise. So I think it's fine.
Yeah, if you have that Elizabeth assist behind her, she'd be swinging for 14k then, which is pretty dope.
Yep.
But yeah, the stock swap effect is super useful. I mean, even if they don't have a whole mountain of stock, right? You can still mess up your opponent's compression too. If your opponent has like only a handful of cards left in their deck with a lot of climaxes, sometimes you could even stock swap them for 2 or 3 just to get some climaxes out of their deck and make them refresh poorly.
Yep, always a useful effect. Moving into climax combos, the Meliodas. I am pretty confident that every single 7 Deadly Sins deck is probably going to play this card. Now that we've seen the rest of the set, I don't think there's too much of a reason to play the bar top end. I don't think there's too much of a reason to do much else other than to play into this, because it's the most unique thing that 7 Deadly Sins has going for it. It is a really strong card. So he's just an 11k if you're playing the game. There's literally no way to whiff the first effect. It's just a power budgeting thing. He's a healer, so even if you're not doing the combo, you're slamming an 11k cross turn healer. which is just really good for, you know, just playing a healer. And then whenever you play the choice, as long as you have a full field, this card gets an additional 1,000 power and the following ability until your end of your opponent's next turn, so cross turn. When the card across from it attacks, you pay one and burn two. Even if your opponent's side attacks to sort of play around the Elizabeth 2-1 that we looked at, you can still burn your opponent for one. It's when they declare an attack. The type of attack that they declare does not matter. So cross turn, he's going to be 11, 12, 15 minimum from the Elizabeth, right? Because she's given 3k.
11 puts him to 13. Right, he sits at 11.
Oh, he'll be 16.
The assist puts him to 13. She gives him 1,000, puts him at 14? Are you gonna 16 if you have double?
No. So he's 11. Sorry, math is so hard. So he got 11.
Oh, wait, he gets 1,000 power for the turn cycle too.
11, 12, 13, 15. And then he'll attack in at 16. I believe that's right. And then he'll also be hexproof, and your opponent can't burn you with auto effects in the lane that he's in. So pretty cool. Defensive and offensive in a way. Like, you're doing burn damage, you're denying your opponent from doing stuff. Sort of like it's like a field-based version of like half of the Charlotte lockdown. Like, your opponent can't burn you out. They're forced to vanilla swing, but then the card that they vanilla swing into is going to burn them, which is pretty crazy.
Aside from being like a unique combo that's like never really been printed in Weiss before, it's also super flavorful to the show. This is a good example of a flavorful card right here.
Yeah, this is a well-designed card for sure in terms of Weiss Schwartz. This card and the Elizabeth are like a slam dunk in terms of how they work.
I'm really excited to play with this Meliodas finisher, actually. Like, I consider myself more of a control player, like in card games in general. And I've always wanted to play like a really good defensive, control-y, for lack of a better word, finisher. And you know, I playing with like the all the soul wall decks, you know, that's fine and good, but those are so easy to answer. And the fact that this has hexproof on it, it can't be targeted, your opponent can't use any shenanigans to get rid of it, really allows you to get like a hard lock on your opponent, and I really, really like that.
Yep. To supplement the really cool Meliodas, we have this slightly less interesting but still kind of cool Bond. He's an on play draw two, drop one, so he can help you dig into climaxes. Really cool. And then he has a climax combo with our level one door, which is the coolest part of the card. So when you get a reverse with this card, as long as you have a full field, you can pay two and then burn three, and then you put that character that you reversed on top of your opponent's deck. So it's not a great climax combo. He doesn't get any additional power. If you have the Elizabeth back row out, he's gonna swing in at 13 around there, which is enough to snipe like a small level three, or at least tie with like a 3k backup or something like that. So you should be able to get it off when you need to. But the big thing here is that this is a proactive finisher, whereas the Meliodas is a like sort of reactive, more defensive type of card. So in the matchups where you're already ahead and you're looking to push for game, and like you have that climax swapper, right? Even if you've been building to play into Meliodas and your opponent eats like sort of a chunk of damage that maybe they weren't supposed to and then had some unfortunate triggers, you can capitalize on that by pivoting into this Bond and like doing an aggressive push for game as opposed to playing down your Meliodas and setting up your wall. So having the option to do so at really no cost, because the level one combo is already fine and comparable to the other combos that you might want to play at level one in this set, you sort to just get this for free. And then this card is also a cantrip, and I think this is probably the thing that throws the Elaine combo over the choice combo, at least for me. Like, theoretically, obviously we don't truly have the set in our hands yet. We're recording this on Wednesday, the set comes out on Friday, so we're just sort of spitballing here, but I think this sort of ability to pivot has always been something I personally have valued when playing different kinds of decks and stuff like that, where you have like modular top end strategies. Like, I really always like Dean's Million Live deck and things like that, where there was always like a lot of choices and lines you could take at the top end. And even though this is only two choices, I think they're both very different but effective choices that you could make.
Yeah, I think it's really, really clutch that the set has this option to pair with the Meliodas finisher. I think it's another way to look at it too, I think, which is similar to how you were maybe saying, you know, in those games where you absolutely cannot let your opponent untap, where maybe they have some sort of burn combo, like a Coco Cochino that's like doing multiple pings on attack that even though they could still just side attack you and get around your anti-burn, they could still like chip you out of the game if you're like high end level 3 damage close to dying. But I think it's definitely so matchup specific in that sense, but I think the one Achilles heel to the Meliodas combo is Megumin and Union from Konosuba. Mm-hmm. Because that is a way that your opponent can just clock kick your Meliodas and deal burn damage to you while completely ignoring your hexproof effect and getting around your burn 2 on the way back. Mm-hmm. And Konosuba is a very strong popular deck, so because that's a matchup that you should expect to play against over the course of a tournament, this is like your ace in the hole. This is your saving grace in those matchups.
Yeah, for sure. It's like a totally reasonable combo. Like, not the best finishing combo, but like, I don't think this is a bad combo by any means.
Yeah, I think you got to look at it like in perspective of what you're playing it into, right? Like, mm-hmm. usually you're going to want to go for the Meliodas, I think. But in matchups like Konosuba specifically, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Bond doesn't get to a huge amount of power like the Meliodas does. But it's not like Konosuba is really playing a backup either. If you can combine this with maybe some of your other power pump effects, or even just the Elizabeth back row to give power, mm-hmm. you should be able to get over them.
Yeah, for sure. Is unfortunately in that matchup susceptible to foreclosure. But then, you know, you're straining your opponent's resources as well to like sort of play around your off finisher, which is pretty good in and of itself. And again,
see, what you got to do is you just got to clutch these cards in your hand. You just can't let your opponent know you have it.
Mm-hmm. And if you gotta have
like
two of them,
you got to telegraph the Meliodas combo and then you get them with this. And they're like, oh my God, he does run it.
If you play two of them and you have at least 5 stock, you can sequence your attacks in a way where foreclosure, they would have to double foreclosure you to stop you. So you should be fine. But yeah, even in those games where you don't really want to play it, this card cantrips into your choice, or a climax, so you can climax swap it out. So it's just an additional 2-card dig into a climax, which is always welcome.
Yeah, even if you are going for the Meliodas, you can draw into your choice climax with this, mm-hmm. or into an Elizabeth or whatever you need.
Yeah. All right, and here is the door choice deck again. I try to keep my sort of theory crafted starting decks where I'm running sort of higher counts than maybe what's needed to start with, and then I cut back. That's just sort of how I've always deck built in this game. That's just always been my preference. So things might be a higher count than maybe they could be. Like maybe we could get away with 2 Brainstorm. Maybe we could play a less Leafa counters. Depends how things shake out. Maybe we don't need the tech cards, things like that. But I always like to start with a lot and then cut backwards and sort of think about the rest of the set and then sort of rotate things in. But this is sort of the starting point.
Looks like you're using just a good mix of the most powerful cards in the set. And even if the list ends up changing over time after people start testing, this looks like a very strong jumping off point to me. A very good springboard, if you will.
Yeah. And like I said, these are available on Encore Deck, so we'll have the links in the description. Real quickly, want to touch on 8 choice. We've been here a bit, this deck, so we'll sort of blow through it here. But this deck runs mostly all the same cards, very few differences. We'll jump into those differences right now. The biggest one is that we're running this level 1 combo instead of the Magro. This is just vanilla cigarettes. It swings in at 7k, so it is quite literally the absolute baseline of a level 1 combo that is on attack that you would choose to play. But that's still fine. It's on choice trigger, so then that puts you into 8 choice, which is interesting. It does give you a lot of sort of stock. What's the way to put this? It gives you a lot of like leeway on stock throughout the game, so you can pay more for maybe more costly effects. But then also the fact that this is a cigarettes combo means that we'll get our lower count level 0s more often because of just the way cigarettes works. Sometimes you mill a climax on a level 0, and that's all you can get. So you want to have sort of high value level 0 targets, and that's why in the list you can see we're running a little lower. Like we have 2 Brainstorm, we have 3 different tech level 0s, stuff like that, because we're going to be able to more realistically get them every game because we're playing a cigarettes combo. So that's really the only real difference. The fact that this puts us into 8 choice and that gives us a little bit more leeway at level 0. One of those level 0s that we'll play is this Elizabeth backup plan. It's an on-play pump 1k anywhere, including herself. And then it has pay 1, sack her, check top 4, add a character. The cigarettes doesn't have the same level of first deck speed that the Elaine does. So when we happen to draw this is just a way to sort of cash out off our clean cut cut has really good synergy with our clean cut. It can send our clean cut to 4-5, and then this gets clean cut, and then this card turns into another card in a 4-card mill, which is always a good interaction. But this does just sort of band-aid our deck speed a little bit while being a relevant power pump effect. The other card is much more interesting. This is one of the only decent auxiliary level 1 yellow cards that you could possibly be playing in Seven Deadly Sins. And I know it's a 1-1. It reads a little weird. It's like a 1-1 6K with hand on core. But the interesting part is this is a 1-1 with a soul trigger that has on play, if you have a full field, you choose a character from your waiting room and you put it into your stock. So this is actually a 1-0 6K hand on core with a soul trigger. The big problem with 8 choice is just getting playable cards for the next turn sometimes, because you can only take usually higher level cards that you can't play at level 1. In the other deck, we're using it to grab backups when we trigger choice to sort of protect our cards that we already have. But when we're playing 8 choice and our cards are small off turns, Elizabeth's only 45, we need to have a way to refund cards or just sort of get cards out there that are attackers. So even when we grab level 0s, even when we add junk, even when we don't have good cards to add, when this card's already down and he's played for free, he's a way to use our junk that we can't play to at least have another attacker on field. And then of course he also has a soul trigger for choice, and he himself is a like costless playable 6k character. So it's a pretty cool way to leverage the 8 choice lineup and sort of make it not as bad, sort of remove the bad things about playing 8 choice. Because I know it seems like a pretty suspicious card, but in terms of how the 8 choice trigger line plays out, I think this card will be a lot better than it probably will.
I mean, it's pretty comparable to the Bond that we had in the last build, right? Just kind of like an on-turn strong attacker. But this is just seems like a necessary evil to have when you're running something like 8 choice. You need to make sure you have enough targets for your choice climaxes, because they can only grab cards that have a soul on them.
Yeah, it's just the best card to support that kind of trigger lineup. Another couple cards, we'll just spell them all here. We have the Diane Childhood. This is just an on attack 6k all the time when you play it. And then when you see a level 2 or higher, it gets an additional 6k, so it's a costless 12k against level 2s. We don't have a lot of ways to challenge standby. With the other deck, we were swinging over 1-1s and stuff like that, but in this one, like, our combo's only getting to 7k. We don't, our other auxiliary card only gets a 7k, so we need to have a way to at least try to do something when they get that 2-2 to front row. So this is kind of our out to that. It's a level 1, so we can grab it off our combo when we hit, so we'll be able to have it crack back if we're in that situation. We're also running the Hawk Fumio, so they did get a 1-card Fumio. The reason we weren't running it in the other deck is because this card costs 3, and you have to rest a standing character, so that's really, really costly. Just a Fumio for 1. This is actually overcosted for the 2-1 profile. In my opinion, the waiver from Fate Apocrypha is like pay 2 overall, discard a card, which is much more reasonable than this. I think pay 3 overall, rest a character is like actually total trash. But the fact that we're like 8 choice means that we do have that stock leeway, so this card actually does become playable. And as a one of, as a card that we can stock away if we're not going to need it off choice, it's a fine include as a one of. But I do think that cost is like actually atrocious. It should have been a pay 2 ditch a card, because pay 3 rest means that you effectively neg an additional card. Your card can't attack, right? So you'd rather just ditch, because then can't even brainstorm if you rest your brainstorm. So yeah, don't.
Yeah,
like,
I think
don't
the goal is you probably want to rest down one of your characters with assist. Maybe the king from earlier, or if you're playing a 2-1 assist, the Elizabeth has to be here. So
yeah,
you know, maybe rest, play the Elizabeth 2-1 assist, and then rest that down with this.
Yeah, so it's a lot more playable in this deck than it is in others, because we have that sort of stock leeway from 8 choice. Last card here, since we don't have the Bond double combo, we get to play this Elizabeth early play, which is a pretty boring but effective early play. It's a 2 or less climax early play with top check X. So it's just a way to rip into climaxes for our end game, or set up a double early play with the Diane, since this is 2 or less and the other one is 4 or more, and the Diane requires you to pitch a card. This makes that whole interaction sort of less hand intensive, and then also puts out 2 additional bodies. You can try to work this card into the door deck as well. I think this card's totally fine as a 1 or 2 of. It just requires you to make a cut somewhere else, which I wasn't willing to make, but it's definitely a card to keep in mind when you're bringing with the set. I think this is a, again, boring but effective early play. It also has Elizabeth on it. Always a
very cute.
But here's that list again as well. Like I said, pretty similar. I'll flip back and forth between them here. You can see just how little changes. Unfortunately for Seven Deadly Sins, there were a couple other ideas that I was kicking over when I was looking at the set. I think the 2-1 Gil Thunder might be exploring, but that deck might be a little spicy. It is running Stoxel instead of a plussing trigger, which is always a little suspect. But like, he's like an early play, and then he's like on reverse, you sack the Climax, and then you can check up to 4 and add up to 4. And then he has like a bonder to him that gives him an additional 1k and like no events and backups, which is pretty cool. But like, those 2-1 cards that require you have a full field at 1 can be a lot more awkward than we'll give it credit for, especially when you don't have things like Ramorous or whatever to like fill your field, like with the Xion and Slime, which was like the way that that deck got away with it. So I don't know, that's like the only other thing. Unfortunately, blue is like really rough, but maybe someone will figure out something out. Maybe somebody will crack the set.
I don't know, Carmen, as a notorious brewer, do you want my opinion?
What do you think?
I think that there's a lot of room to play around with, right? Like, the Meliodas combo is really strong, and like, if you're just like looking like at like the facts and looking at, you know, what does the card do? It has the heal, it has the burn damage, it has the anti-burn with the Elizabeth. It's really, really solid, but that's an entire package of cards you have to run to support it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe you don't want to have to be forced into 8 choice. Maybe you want to run a different combo at the top end, right?
Mm-hmm.
You could maybe choose to use the King with the gold bar. Frees up a lot of deck spots too, by not having to run all the Elizabeth assists.
True.
The blue villain deck looks kind of interesting too. You get to run some of the blue payoff cards you mentioned earlier. So I think that would be fun to explore, at least as a budget option.
Yeah, the big problem with the blue deck is that the top end is like legitimately terrible, I think. But you could probably run it's not like trait locked, it's more color locked. So you might be able to run like the Bon or the Bar top end in that, or like maybe even the Meliodas. It might be something worth looking
at. I'm going to be honest, Carmen, I'm just trying to hype up the set here. I haven't actually looked at any of the blue cards.
As we get to the end here, you know.
But Jericho is a cutie. She is my favorite character from the show, I could definitely like to build a deck with her. But I do have one more thing to say too.
Mm-hmm.
I think the build with maybe the most potential going forward, something that I'm very interested in messing around with personally, is since you have the double combo, right, with mm-hmm. Bon and the what's her name, the Elaine,
mm-hmm.
Off the gate trigger that we had in the first deck we showcased here, I think that opens up the space to put in another Climax combo, right? If you have that as your level 1 and level 3, you can maybe run one of the more interesting level 2 combos, or maybe there's a level 0 Climax combo, and you can kind of run like a triple Climax combo deck and be doing something impactful at every level. Depending how spicy you want to get, right, regardless of that, the fact that the level 1 and level 3 combo with the Bon and the Elaine is good enough on both ends really opens up a lot of deck building space, I think, if you want to get creative.
Yep, I think the only thing with that is we'll just have to see, because
it's way too early to tell.
Yeah, it's too early to tell, and we also have our set review coming up. Unfortunately, we have a big tournament this weekend that we'll be heading out to in Jersey, the CGU tournament. If anybody's going to be there, definitely hit us up while we're there. We'll be there the whole weekend. We get some games, just hang out. Might be pretty cool. If you're there, let us know. Drop us a comment or whatever. Let us know that you'll be there. But because of that,
first big tournament since you know,
everything.
The big C like died down a little bit.
The only thing with that is that the set review is going to have to be pushed back to next week, but we are going to get it out. 7 Deadly Sins, probably get that out before we get out the Morphonica Wrath stuff, depending on how our recording goes, but we want to get that out as quickly as possible. But, you know, with the way the week's going, and I think, what is it, Brian and Tyler are also going on vacation, like we are, our usual content team is fractured or busy on the coming weekend, so we're going to get that out as quickly as we can. In terms of other stuff, we got always the Card Games and Competitive Voice Sports Discord. If you're looking to talk about Weiss, maybe get some webcam games or play on Weiss Fight and talk to people at the same time, you can definitely check those out. Global and NA, you're looking to buy, sell, trade Weiss Schwartz with other players, as well as get the lowdown on new JP releases translated to English, you can check out Global. The JP release stuff is also in the Discords. There are channels for that pump all of it there. So either one, whatever you like. I know some people don't like Facebook, you can get away with just Discord. Then, of course, Weiss Fight, weissfight.net. If you want to try 7 Deadly Sins and you don't have the set in, you're waiting on your case or you're just looking to try before you buy, hop onto Wise Fight, grab the Encore decks links we have in the description. You can try these decks without even getting your cards in yet and just give it a try. You don't even have to be in voice chat. Just work kind of like Dueling Book. You hop on there and just sort of get in voice chat and play some games. The dev also has a Patreon open if you're looking to support that project so that they can get better and better. We'll have the link to that in the description as well. Definitely check that out. Andy, you got anything else before we go?
Yeah, maybe keep an eye out for another Seven Deadly Sins deck tech at some point too. It's definitely a set that I'm buying into and want to mess around with. Maybe drop a comment down below. Let me know what the coolest thing I can put in my Double Climax combo deck would be.
Yeah, I think it'll be really cool to just sort of revisit the set later, sort of have our smoke test out here now, and then we'll see how it goes after the fact.
See how neat. The set review inspires me.
Mm-hmm. All right, and with that, Pittsburgh Whiteford signing off. We'll see you guys in the next one.
See you guys.